You're watching a series called Light in the Darkness, a journey through the Gospel of John from the Axis Church in downtown Nashville. For more information and resources, visit theaxischurch.org.
This morning we have the privilege to host Chad Miller, Pastor Chad Miller, with us as he continues preaching through our series in the book of John. Chad and his wife Ashley have been married for 25 years. They only have five kids. They have four sons, and they finally got it right. They got one daughter, and the age ranges from 18 to 6. He's been serving in the local church since he became a Christian in 1993. In fact, Chad and I served at the same church, the one that I left to come here to plant 15 years ago. And so we were on staff together, which is pretty cool. This year, he planted and is still continuing to plant Mission Bible Church in Charlotte, North Carolina, where he is the lead pastor. Axis, our family here, is a founding partner in this through financial gifts as well as coaching and encouragement. He's a participating pastor in the network we started, Partnership of Associated Churches. You know it as PAC. Chad loves his family. Chad loves the word of the Lord. He's my friend. He has a passion for Jesus, and he has a passion for discipleship, for making disciples. I trust this man. I've known him for 18 years. And I know when you have a new person come and you don't know who they are, it's easy, if you're like me, to kind of be skeptical. They have to earn the right to be trusted, and I get that. Use discernment. But as much as you can trust me, you can trust him. And accept him. As we have asked him to come continue in this series for you. I'm excited to welcome him, and I ask that you at this time welcome Pastor Chad Miller.
Thank you, brother. I love you. That's a joy to be with you. Keep your Bibles open as we are just about to transition into that text, and I've watched so many of your live streams, Jeremy. I can plug the scripture journal if you want me to. That we have scripture journals for you. If you don't have one, Jordan will come find you. They're awesome. They've got the scripture on the left side and a place for you to journal on the right. You can write down a key takeaway from the sermon. That's important to do. Take notes, or as you're digesting the word throughout the week, write down how the Lord's speaking to you. We use them at Mission Bible. We're not in John, so we won't take any of yours, Jeremy, I promise. But it's a joy to be with you. Well, standard rules don't apply because we're such close and tight family. You don't know me. I know you by proxy. I have prayed for you. I have, well, this is quick. I've wept with your pastor over you for your spiritual health and growth in the Lord, that you might be a lighthouse in a world that is desperate for hope. Your friends and family are watching you live this thing called life, and they may never pick up a Bible because they're not Christians yet, but they are reading your life. Paul would write that we are living epistles written so that all men might read. And so I'm praying that you and I walk in a manner that's worthy of the gospel this week. What a joy to be with you. We're continuing our series, Light in the Darkness, and journeying through John's gospel. And the three questions that your pastor has been wrestling with, or that have been wrestling him over the course of this series, have ministered to me because they come up. You've got some pastors and some preachers and teachers in your life, the Axis, who don't just get up and sermonize on Sunday. We actually try to not just believe the text that we present, but live it out in a way that we can preach it with conviction. It's one thing for us to try to live what we preach. It's another thing for us to preach what we live. And that's our goal in being handled by the Word of God. The three questions: are you a Christian? When did you become a Christian? Or how did you become a Christian? And what does Jesus mean to you today? Have y'all heard that before? Yes, Pastor Jeremy said that many times. That last question will rock your world if you'll let it through this text that we're about to work through. The Word of God was not given to make us stronger Christians, or rather stronger, smarter people who can win arguments. That's where I was going with that. I've got a friend who said he went to a member's house one time who said, "Follow me," and he took him down to the basement. A little nervous in 2024 when a man tells me to follow him somewhere, but he took him down to the basement, showed him his collection of books, wall-to-wall books, the envy of any pastor. Jeremy, you've got a collection in your office. It's impressive. From what I understand, this guy's was like, wow. It's the stuff you and I can't afford. He had bought all that with disposable income and had this collection of books. And Gary, my buddy, said, "Why do you have all of these commentaries and all this stuff? This guy's not even a preacher of the word." He said, "Because I like to win arguments." That was his personality too. The word of God was not given to just give us information or inspiration. God's word was given so that we might be transformed by the author. In fact, John says in John 20, 31, these things were written, everything that you're discussing in this study were written so that you might believe what? That Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life, the life that only comes through his name. Believe that Jesus is who the scriptures reveal him to be. Have life that's worth living according to God's word. Last week, Pastor Jeremy dropped us off at verse 15. Inviting us to fall in love with a baker and stop chasing the bread. Thousands were fed last week. What a miracle. But I don't know if you remember this. The disciples didn't sign up for a feeding program. They didn't say, Jesus didn't say, "Hey, come with me. We're about to do something amazing." They just wanted to hang out with Jesus. And the crowd found him. And ministry happened. And life got busy. I want us to see what happens next right after that. Right after the feeding of 5,000, Matthew gives us a little bit of insight into what's happening here. Immediately, the disciples were told to get into the boat. The text says in Matthew, Jesus made them get into the boat. Get into the boat. Go to the other side while he's dismissing the crowds. Verse 15 of the text from last week, the crowds are coming. They want to elect Jesus as a leader. They're like, "Hey, let's put him in charge of everything. He can lead a revolution." He didn't come to do that. He came to change lives. And then we come to verses 16 and 17. We're just going to work through the text and let the text work through us this morning. Don't tell Mission Bible, but I only have 2 points. I'm a three-pointer, and I try not to be. It's just the fire I was saved in. It's like the sickness. I don't know if you've seen the movie where the guy sees numbers all over the wall. Any text I look at, I see 3 points. So the axis, you're special. You get 2 today. Look at the text with me. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea. They got into a boat and started across the sea to Capernaum. Look at these words. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. Let's pray. Father, one more time, we just bow before you. We ask you to pierce us with the word and to heal us with the word this morning. Help us to lean in to the text, God. Give us eyes of faith, minds that are teachable, hearts that are soft, and ears that are perking up to what you would say to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. When we're preaching and handling the word, I was taught that there are essentially 3 things that every sermon should do with a text. And every message that we preach and teach, we should bring out in the text, there's something to know, something to feel, and something to do. Well, we're going to see some narrative on what's happening in the text. They're going to show us some things that Jesus is doing with the disciples. There's something to know. There's something to feel. That's a really strong impulse in this text, and I want you to feel it with me. The do is actually really quite simple to read on paper. It's actually quite hard to live out once we get in our cars and pull off the property. But I want you to feel these 2 strong emotions in the text. The first one is discouragement. You could even write down despair. The disciples are obeying Jesus. They've just been near Jesus. They wanted to be with him, but they've been near him because they wanted to hang out with him, and the people show up, and then they've got to feed folks. And if you've ever served at an outreach event before, you're usually not near the person that's organized it. They've given you stuff to do, and you're out among the people. And that's where they were, carrying those baskets. It was just incredible what's happened. And now Jesus has said, hey, guys, this is over. And I wonder if they're like, I keep bumping this. I'm going to knock it over. I'm so sorry. I've never been tall or big in any space, so this is amazing. I feel awesome. My buddy Mark told me, he said, that pulpit's kind of tall. I think it'll hit you here. And I'm just loving life that it doesn't this morning. It's great. Jesus comes to them after he's dismissed the crowd, sent them on their way, and I bet, I don't know this, I'm just imagining if I were among the disciples, I'm thinking, finally, we get to hang out with Jesus. And what does he say? Get in the boat, go ahead of me, I'm going up to the mountain. I'm sorry, what? I thought, like you said, you wanted to be with us. What gives? Where's Jesus? Notice the words used here. It's a dark night in the text, a dark night. They're without Jesus. I can't imagine they're not totally physically exhausted from the day and the demands of the day. The crowds found them. They had to do ministry, or if you want to say it the correct way, they got to do ministry. Amazing, miraculous, but exhausting ministry. And then Jesus heads to the mountains, sends them on their way. It's the opposite of what they wanted, but this is often the case. It's exactly what they needed. We just don't see that yet. Question for you. I wonder, if you look back on your week this week and somebody asks you how your life is panning out for you, is it what you wanted? How about your relationship with the Lord? Is it what you want? Are you where you want to be? Verse 18, the sea becomes rough. Boy, the language here is really forgiving to just how rough the sea became. Some of the other gospels give us some insight into this, but it becomes rough because a strong wind was blowing. They're getting miles now into the journey on the Sea of Galilee. And this sea is subject to major storms. You can't call them hurricanes. That's not technically what they are, but the winds are the same. Based on where the Sea of Galilee is, and I've had the privilege, as some of you have, of being there on the Sea of Galilee. And you see these hills all around, these mountain cliffs all around. And it looks like the finger of God carved that thing out just so wind could whip through there anytime it wanted to and be devastating. This strange, angry storm came from out of nowhere. Matthew says the boat was beaten by the waves. Abused, bullied is what it looks like. The wind is against them. They are heading headlong into the storm. Now, they've seen storms before. They're fishermen. In fact, they've seen Jesus calm storms before, but he's not with them. He's not on the boat. They're on their own. They had hoped for encouragement in their time with Jesus, but instead, they're tasting discouragement because all they see is the storm. Verse 19. It's like they're done. They'd rowed 3 or 4 miles out into there, and they're got to be nearing the point of physical exhaustion and stopping. And then it says they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were excited. No, they were immediately peace. Flood, they began to sing hymns and psalms and spiritual songs and speak to one another and just float on clouds and sing the hallelujah chorus. That's not what it says. It says they saw Jesus coming near the boat and they were frightened. They've been at it all night. Other gospels would tell us it's now between 3 and 6 a.m. in the morning. They've been rowing all night, trying to keep the ship together just to make it a little bit at a time, rowing against the wind. Why didn't Jesus come sooner? Why didn't Jesus show up when the storm started? Why didn't Jesus show up before they even got in the boat and say, you know what? You guys really need me with you right now. I'm going to hang out with you guys. Why did he wait? They've been out there for a long time. 6 hours they've been out there on the boat in the darkest part of the night with the storm raging. 6 hours he's been away from them when they needed him. They're out there pulling, straining at the oars. Mark tells us that Jesus comes in the fourth watch of the night, which is the darkest of the darkest hour. Can you feel it? The sense of abandonment? I know you all at the Axis are really spiritual, so you would never probably admit to this, but can I just tell you, I've felt this and I know better. I know some of the scripture verses you know and memorized and that are in your daily reading plans. I've sat through similar groups like the Axis community groups. I've done that and I've talked to brothers. I've encouraged other people and say, look, it doesn't matter how you feel, God is with you. And then I've had to go cry by myself because I don't feel him. And I wonder where he is. Abandon is not an inaccurate description. For 6 long agonizing hours, they're out there and it seems like God has forgotten them. In this moment, the storm is creating for them a false narrative. Storms are great at doing that. It will actually impact their vision as well. Remember, they've seen so many miracles. They've been with Jesus. They had just participated in a massive scale miracle. They've acknowledged that Jesus was the only one worth following. They had left their nets to follow Jesus. And yet, as is often the case, though their theology was intact, the biography that was being written in real time was telling a different story. Where is he? Does he know about us? And some spiritual person would say, of course he knows. And they would say, well, then where is he? Can he see what we're going through? Of course he sees. He's God. Then where is he? Does he care? Am I allowed to say that? Of course he cares. Then where is he? Why didn't he come sooner? Is Jesus being cruel? Does he just want them to suffer? We can only imagine with their backs aching, looking into the mouth of a watery grave, they're asking, where is Jesus? Where is Jesus? If he could feed 5,000, why can't he show up for us? And yet Mark's gospel tells us he had his eye on them the entire time. He was praying for them the entire time. He saw that they were straining. He had not forgotten them. So why would he wait? Why would he wait? Can I ask you to take your pens in that journal or wherever you're taking note, and I want you to write a scripture down that may encourage you if you find yourself proverbially on the boat in the middle of the night, hours into something that you know Jesus could have fixed in a second. And you're tempted to say, where in the world are you? Isaiah 30:18. Therefore, the Lord waits. Why does he wait? To be gracious to you. And therefore, he exalts himself to show mercy to you. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for him. I wonder if you would just say the first part of that verse with me. We'll stop at mercy to you. Can you do that with me? Therefore, the Lord waits. Ready? Therefore, the Lord waits to be gracious to you. Next part. And therefore, he exalts himself to show mercy to you. Do you understand that God knows exactly the right time to show up? And it may seem like he is abandoning you or letting you exhaust all of your resources, but his chief interest is his glory. But thank God he is glorified when he is gracious and merciful to us when we need him most. He shows up. We just read the verse. He showed up where they needed him most. They see him, but they're still frightened. Why? Because all they can see is the storm. And they're letting the storm be the filter of everything that they're seeing on the other side of the storm. When you let the circumstances of life and that false narrative that the enemy would have you believe, when you let that dictate how you see everything else, it will give you a blurred vision of the living God. He'll not only catch you off guard. Matthew says, they said, it's a ghost. Now, I'm not one here to beat up on the disciples. They're an easy target sometime, though. Have you ever done that? Like Israel, you're reading the Old Testament, like, come on, guys, we just went through this. The disciples do it. They say it's a ghost. Question for you, Bible trivia nerds. Were they accustomed to seeing ghosts on the water? Like, why would they say that? But they say it, they're freaked out. Why? Because the storm has them all messed up. Because that's all they see. Christ comes to them on the water. They see him. Mark says he saw them the whole time. He saw they were painfully making headway. He saw what was against them. And he sees you, dear brother, dear sister. He sees the very thing that is surrounding you, that is affecting your vision. And causing you to see things in a way that are not necessarily truthful. He sees the darkness. He sees the loneliness. He sees the grief. He sees the toil that you are engaged in, the fact that you are straining just to try to keep it together. He sees that sense of hopelessness. He sees the loss of control, and he is with you, whether you see him or not, whether you feel him or not. They see Jesus walking on the water between 3 and 6 a.m. He's walking on the very thing that was threatening to destroy them. Can I just tell you, whatever you're facing is under his feet. He has all authority. He's not sweat one bullet over your trial, but he has felt your pain as you've gone through it. Jeremy and I were feasting on this passage earlier this week, and he reminded me of a quote from A.W. Pink. Look around and we'll be disheartened. Look within and we shall be discouraged. But look unto him and our fears will vanish. So they see Jesus. Verse 20, he speaks. They're still discouraged. Remember, they think it's a ghost. They're still frightened. Jesus speaks, John 6:20, and what does he say to them? He says, it is I. Do not be afraid. He's walking on the water. He comes to the side of the boat. Immediately they see him and he speaks. He doesn't say, of all the things he could have said there, by the way, I've got a list of things I'd like to hear him say. If I've been rowing for hours, in a storm for hours, about to give up for hours, wondering where he's been for hours, here's some things I want to hear. How about you? Let's get out of here. No? Just me? Hey, why are you in this mess? I'll take that. You said go, right? I would just say, you told us to go. That's why we're here. How about, I've come to rescue you. That's a humdinger. Or maybe he says, watch this. In the South, we do that. Hold my sweet tea. Watch this, right? And he's going to calm the storm again. There's some other things that I think some well-meaning Christians tell us when we're in the middle of something that don't always land well, like, you know, it's always darkest just before the dawn. Now, I don't want to get too churchy on you, but when people say things like that to me, I want to say, touch them, Lord, and use my hand. Hold on just a little longer. I would have liked to hear Jesus say, you're almost there. What does he say? It's I, a revelation. Don't be afraid, a command. Did you know that God's word gives us 365 versions of that command? Fear not. Don't be afraid. There have been seasons in my life where I've needed one every day. There have been other seasons where I've needed one every hour because the storm was so intense and everything was so dark. It's I, he says. Dear brother and sister, hang with me for just a few more moments. We're just about to move from discouragement to delight. But they don't get there because the storm stops. If you watch the tense of the text that we're going to see in just a moment, you're going to notice they get delighted while the storm is still raging. And it's still super, super dark. More than deliverance, what Jesus is saying, you just need me. More than a breakthrough, you need me while you're broken down. More than a miracle, you just need to be with me. Who is Jesus to you? I know he's a burden bearer, a heavy load carrier, a heart fixer, and a mind regulator, a way maker, but more than that, he is Emmanuel. That is the scandalous claim of the New Testament, that God is with us. He is the treasure worth finding. He is our God. The prophet Isaiah would say, with God being removed, speaking through the prophet would say, "Fear not," speaking on behalf of God. "I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my right hand." He's the light of our salvation, not because of something he's about to do, but because of who he is and what he's already done. The Lord is our strength. He's our refuge. I want to suggest to you, dear brother or sister, I know you want the storm to stop. I know you want the darkness to fade, but you need something greater in your life than for the winds to die down, even though they are knocking you down. You need something greater in your life than for the waves to stop raging, even though they're about to tear up the very thing you are about to protect. You have a greater need than relief from straining at the oars. You need Jesus. And to see him clearly as you live this thing called life. The winds and the waves don't hinder Jesus from getting to his people. He's greater than the storm. He can see through it. The winds and the waves have no effect on Jesus getting to where they are. He's greater. He can walk on them. And then that point we just put up, they delight in him. Verse 21, if you look at it, it says, "Then they were glad to take him in the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land to which they were going." Now, can I tell you something about my immature self? I am 47 years old. I've been a Christian longer than I should be for me to about to admit to you my favorite part of verse 21 for much of my Christian life. You ready? The second part of it where it says, "And immediately the boat was at the land to which they were going." Don't you love that? I mean, Jesus is a miracle worker and they let him in the boat and boom, they're on the other side. That's a descriptive thing of what happens. It doesn't happen like that every time. You know what the greater power of that verse is? Then they were glad. They may not have been sure what they were seeing, but when Jesus said, "It is I, be not afraid," they knew his voice. The Bible says that Jesus spoke as one who had authority, not as the scribes. There was something distinctive about his voice. John 27, which you'll get to later in your study, the Bible says, "My sheep," Jesus speaking, "hear my voice. I know them and they follow me." Mary was in the garden at the resurrection. She thought he was a gardener, the resurrected Christ, until he spoke her name. I've sat where you've sat, though. Theologically, I got it. Doctrinally, I was secure. Yep, I know. Jesus is with us. He said he'd never leave us nor forsake us, but experientially, I was struggling. Everything was so dark. The winds were so loud. The waves are too high. Everything was freaking me out, and I was beginning to see things in a way that wasn't true. I just wanted it to be over. I just wanted to get to the other side. But God's word shows us here, my greatest need, your greatest need, is just to be satisfied with who Jesus is. Because a storm may last. There may still be some hours of darkness to go through. But if you have a clear picture of who Jesus is, you can be glad and delight where others would despair. The Lord said to us in Isaiah 43, "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by my name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned. What a promise. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. Jesus made no promise to the disciples about the storm. You and I can come up with a list of things we'd like to hear in the midst of our storm, but here's what Jesus is saying to us this morning in 2024. It is I. Don't be afraid. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth, the storms of life, the darkness of night will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Man, I want to be that kind of Christian, don't you? I want to be the kind of Christian that when everything seems to be falling apart, I recognize that I'm secure in who Christ is. I want to be that kind of Christian that, man, just seeing Jesus, I can recalibrate and become glad that he is with me, even when the storm is raging and the dark is continuing on. But there are times that I long to be that immediately. Lord, just get me out of this. Sometimes following Jesus will take us headlong into a storm. Sometimes obeying Jesus will point us right in the direction of a storm. The Bible talks about all kinds of storms. There are correcting storms for us. Jonah was in a correcting storm. And there are perfecting storms that help us grow up and catch a better glimpse of who he is. You need the baker more than the bread. More than a miracle, you need the miracle worker, the Lord Jesus Christ. You need the sea walker more than you need the sea stilled. You and I need Jesus, and we'll never be satisfied or truly gladdened until we cast ourselves on him and invite him into our boats. I'm closing now. We're just about to respond with a time of communion, but I just wanted to assure you, you're loved. You are cherished. You, brother and sister in Christ, you've been empowered by the living God to live for him as he lives through you. You are adopted by the King of Glory. Jesus sees you, even when you don't believe that. He knows you, even when you think he can't be bothered with what you're going through. He knows how much you can bear. You're not alone. You're not abandoned, because unlike the disciples who needed the truly God and truly man, Christ Jesus, to be with them in that moment, when Christ ascended into heaven, after Pentecost, he gave the church the promise of the Spirit that would be in us. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. Invite him into the boat of your storm this morning. Be encouraged. Let your heart be gladdened, not because immediately things are about to change, but because Christ Jesus is with us. Amen. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. The storm may persist, but you can be glad by his presence. Father, thank you so much for your word this morning. As we meditate on the promises that you give us in your word, we recognize that your word was written to bring comfort and assurance to those who are in Christ. Lord, we have peace because we are in Christ. We can have calm in the midst of the storm, even when the world is raging, because we are with you and you are with and in us, Lord, and we love you for that. As my brothers and sisters just take a moment to meditate on their answer to who is Jesus to them today, or maybe where is Jesus in the midst of their storm, God, would you help us if the storm is causing us to have a skewed vision of the truth? Help us to bring you closer into our most vulnerable and exhausted spaces, right in the midst of our boats, so we can be gladdened. In Jesus' name, amen. A couple ways to respond to the text. There's something to know, something to feel. Here's something to do for you. Don't let the storm. Be on guard for when the storm gives you a distorted view of Christ. Fight the drift. I've heard that somewhere before. Fight the drift. For those of us who are Christians, one of the ways that we respond to the text in the moment, especially here at the Axis, is we respond with communion. It's a beautiful act of worship that we do together as a family. For those who believe in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, we're going to come to the Lord's table together as we take and dip and taste today. We get to remind ourselves of the perfect life and sacrificial death of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember who Jesus is. Remember what he's already done for you, and remember the Lord's nearness. Christian, this is for you. We'll have four servers across the front to help you this morning. We're going to invite the families to come just after I pray. These are the gifts of God for the people of God, Lord. We proclaim the mystery of the faith that Christ has come. Christ lived. Christ has died. Christ is risen. He has ascended into heaven, and Christ will come again. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be on this time of communion as we feast together, and remain with us always. Amen. Christian, when you're ready, please come and take, remembering the finished work of Christ, the sea walker who's with us in the midst of our storms.